Welcome to Occult of Personality, esoteric podcast extraordinaire at occultofpersonality.net. I'm your host, Greg Kaminsky, and your co-host is Rudolph Berger. This is episode number 186, featuring an interview with author Richard Gavin. Occult of Personality podcast is made possible by you, the listeners, and by the subscribers to the Chamber of Reflection at chamberofreflection.com, our membership site, as well as all those who support us via Patreon. Occult of Personality podcast is also sponsored by Miskatonic Books, an online store that focuses on the esoteric, occult, ceremonial magic, Freemasonry, Rosicrucianism, witchcraft, the Golden Dawn, as well as dark fantasy, classic horror, and supernatural fiction. They carry books by all your favorite esoteric publishers as well. Just visit miskatonicbooks.com. Temple of Thelema is a true outer order of the greater mysteries, providing ceremonial initiation, structured training, and regular group work, all in conformity with the principles of the Book of the Law. An investment of time, effort, and commitment is expected from each member. Each is expected to aspire fervently to the great work, to dare with courage undaunted, to perfect that work, and ever to apply his or her best effort to effect harmony within the order and within the world in general. Founded in service to the AA, College of Thelema seeks to guide the student to an understanding of the law of Thelema. Most especially, this means a deeper understanding of oneself and of one's true will. A combination of instruction techniques is employed, including seminars, written texts, and individual work. For over 40 years, College of Thelema has published journals in The Continuum and Black Pearl, as well as several books on occult subjects, maintaining high standards in Thelemic education. Visit Temple of Thelema at www.thelema.org. Anathema Publishing Limited, quality occult books and contemporary esoterica. Established in 2011, Anathema Publishing aims to provide superior literature in content and form by creating a trinosophic relationship in troth and gabo between publisher, author, and reader. Anathema Publishing produces refined books for the true bibliophile on topics ranging from Gnosticism, traditional craft, alchemy, hermeticism, witchcraft, to Luciferian theosophy. www.anathemapublishing.com. Now, in episode number 186... we're joined by Richard Gavin to discuss his collection of dark fiction entitled Sylvan Dread, available from Three Hands Press. The 12 tales in Sylvan Dread examine the sinister pastoral, the transgressive power emergent from the landscape, the forlorn place, and the nightmare-inducing power of its concealed entic forms. Richard Gavin is an acclaimed author whose work explores the realm where dread and the sublime conjoin. His supernatural tales have been published in 5 collections, including Sylvan Dread and At Fear's Altar. In 2015, he co-edited Penumbrae, an occult fiction anthology. Richard's works of esotericism have appeared in Starfire Journal, Clavis, Journal of Occult Arts, Letters and Experience, and The Luminous Stone. His nocturnal manifesto, The Benighted Path, Primeval Gnosis, and The Monstrous Soul, was released by Theion Publishing in 2016. You can find Richard Gavin online at www.richardgavin.net. I think Richard's work is exemplary in the realm of modern supernatural fiction. The dark tales in Sylvan Dread not only take the reader for a journey, they convey an unexpected depth of visceral feeling. While I didn't have a chance to read his manifesto, The Benighted Path, it was eminently interesting to explore its themes with him a bit during our conversation. I hope you agree. Richard Gavin, I want to welcome you to A Cult of Personality. Thank you so much for joining us this evening. It's a pleasure to speak with you.
Oh, likewise. I greatly appreciate the opportunity. I've listened to the podcast for many years, and it's a pleasure to take part in it tonight.
Good evening also from over here.
And hello, Rudolph.
This evening, we're going to begin by focusing primarily on your book, Sylvan Dread, Tales of Pastoral Darkness, which is a group of tales that drew me in quite a bit. You're really good at evoking a mood. I'm sure you hear this a lot probably from your readers, but good job for sure on this one.
Well, that's wonderful to hear. I appreciate it. I really appreciate that. Yes, definitely. Mood and atmosphere are absolutely integral to my fiction. I think that the quality of atmosphere, especially in supernatural fiction or in occult fiction, is even more vital than perhaps in other forms of literature, simply because I've always been of the belief that the occult tale or the supernatural tale is one of the most direct and personal ways that readers and authors can broach topics to deal with the numinous, with the sacred. And part of the way that we can do this is through the building of atmosphere, because I find that when, as you mentioned, Greg, a reader is drawn in to a particular narrative, their defenses are lowered. The rational approach that they may take to some of the principles, it's lessened slightly, only because they're encountering this story as a narrative, and they can then interact, and they're more willing to entertain possibility of some of these more occult principles or esoteric principles. So that's one of the main reasons why I try to create an ambience, if you will, through prose to make it possible for people to experience these kinds of principles.
It's brilliant.
You just said something that jumped to my ear. You said numinous versus sacred, if I got it completely right. I find it interesting that you oppose those two terms in that context of your fiction writing. Could you expand a bit on that?
Well, it actually was not an opposition per se, really just using two different terms. I see them as essentially one and the same,
yes.
Deep interconnection. I think both the notion of the sacred and the numinous, they carry with it such emotional heft that I see them deeply connected to the emotions of fear, of dread, of awe. And when you look at a lot of the, what could be called the classics or even the masterpieces of supernatural fiction on through world literature, whether it's Algernon Blackwood or Arthur Machen or on down the line, you see this strong interconnection where, yes, some of the imagery may be dark and some of the situations may involve evoking fear or dread, but often that becomes a portal, and what opens up is this sense of wonder, this sense of awe. It leads to a deepening of perception, and I believe that fiction can do this as well. It's not merely just observing what a particular character goes through in a story. If you convey it properly, and if a reader is very much attuned to the music of the piece, if you will, they'll hear that song and they will respond to it. It will stir those kind of deeper emotions in them, and hopefully, you know, awaken in them a sense of the numinous, a sense of the sacred.
Can you talk a little bit about the forest, the woods, sort of the darkness of nature, that those deeper aspects? Because I think your book really highlights a lot of that sort of atmosphere. It makes me feel like I'm right there, the way you describe it, so with so much detail.
Well, I greatly appreciate that. That's wonderful to hear. Yes, absolutely. All of the stories in Sylvan Dread drew upon nature in some aspect. And what I've always loved about the natural world is a very important fact that we tend to forget, especially in modern times where we're so divorced from nature through the course of our day-to-day lives, where we've become so dependent on technology and so, you know, we dwell in cities most of the time, and we just tend to forget that we are part of this living thing, which is the earth, this ancient living force that is inhabited by forms both seen and, in my opinion, unseen, in terms of spirits of place, which, you know, encounters with those types of genius loci, for instance, directly inspired a lot of those stories. I hike as often as I possibly can. You know, my wife and I try to spend as much time in nature as we possibly can. And I think that one of the great things about both the beautiful and the often frightening aspect is that we realize when you've spent a bit of time in nature, if you've gone camping or if you've just gone for an extended hike, you suddenly grow centered and you really do become aware of the depth of the world and how very often we move through our lives with the environment that we're moving through is just kind of wallpaper. You know, we don't really pay that much attention to it, but if we become focused and just, you know, look around our environment in nature, you suddenly become aware of the fact that we are part of this planet, that we have grown out of it, that we are still greatly dependent on it, that we are interconnected with it, and that there is this vast, you know, eons and eons of history that dwell in these cycles of nature, and in both the observable aspects of nature and also, I think, as I mentioned, the unseen or the hidden or the occult aspects of nature. And the stories in Sylvan Dread, I hope, present possibilities or of a kind of way that you can appreciate nature in what I would call a poetical way, and with using the poetic sense, where you're appreciating it not just as a resource or as the place in which you live, but as this source of incredible power and beauty and timelessness.
That sounds interesting to me, because there, in my point of view, are different ways of approaching that question. On one hand, you find also fiction, which I don't think is your case, where nature is seen as the threat which causes fear and those emotions that you were mentioning earlier. In your case, I understand it differently. It is through the living or through the experience of nature and through the encounter with nature, you get an expansion of your feeling, and that's why you add feelings like threat and fear also to your spectrum of feelings. Am I right, or would you explain it?
Absolutely. No, I think you're absolutely correct. And it's interesting, one of the elements that you see, as you mentioned, there are, of course, all kinds of different stories where nature is a threat, where it's seen as, you know, something that humans have to combat. I find those stories very telling of the perception that many people hold, which is that there is a almost neurotic desire to control the world, control our lives. In this sense, nature is almost like the trickster, you know, in occult lore, where it will deliberately upset the apple cart simply to upset the apple cart because it does not abide by our rules. You know, there are observable laws of nature and things that are going to happen you know, day to day, we know that the, you know, the sun is going to rise in the east and set in the west and so on and so forth. However, we can never really control nature. It is really that sort of wild pagan force. And there, perhaps for some people, they find that a troubling concept because they do wish to have a more staid and controlled life. They do want to feel that they are, you know, at the center of things and that they've got everything under control. I've always been drawn to the non-human, to the wild, to the uncontrollable and the unpredictable and the bewildering. And that's why for me, a lot of the those types of elements that manifest in my fiction, it is seen as more of a revelatory force rather than a malicious force.
Mm-hmm. So just an additional question to that, very short. Is man part of nature for you, or is man outside of nature and trying to experience it?
Ah, that's an excellent question. I think that ultimately we are indeed part of nature, but part of a more complex model of nature. Obviously, we differ from the other members of the animal kingdom, for instance. You know, we have the ability to rationalize, we have speech, you know, we have all of these other abilities. But of course, anyone that's particularly involved with any degree of esoteric work comes to understand the subtleties and the depths and the complexities of any sort of reality model. So when we're looking at the planet and we're looking at nature, and which will lead to contemplations of the cosmos, we see that it's not just a single tidy model. It's this sprawling, incredibly complex, incredibly overwhelming, beautiful, frightening, powerful entity of which we are part, but we are a part of this very complex and subtle aspect. So I hope that explains my position a little bit.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you.
Yeah, that's really interesting. When you talk about these models of reality, I'm curious, I know you wrote a piece for Clavis, which kind of talks about the image, sort of realizing reality through images. That's definitely a good aspect of it. I mean, the whole relationship between the way we perceive things, light, the eye, obviously the artistic and creative capabilities. But maybe you could talk a little bit more about how image, you know, informs that view of reality.
Absolutely. You know, this really is a running thread throughout my life, and it goes all the way back to childhood, which I've always been curious because I find that most esotericists or occultists, when you ask them how they first became interested, it very often goes back to early childhood. And for me, I found that at a very young age, the sort of linear model of the world, the routines of school and so forth, were really baffling to me because I had always had this great affinity to enter what I now realize were almost trance states. And image was very important. I was a prodigious dreamer going all the way back to my earliest childhood memories. That was a gift, a knack that I had from birth, presumably, was this incredible ability to dream. So my dream life became very important to me. And as I began to develop an interest in prose writing, I began to realize the importance of image and how I would sort of have, you know, what in Kabbalistic terms I suppose would be called the kind of Yetzeratic vision. I would have these images that had no real material basis, and yet they were incredibly rich and vivid and seemingly filled with meaning. And again, they just sort of radiated this incredible intrigue and power. And I began to pursue that. And as I moved on through life and experimented with various trance techniques and magical technologies, I came to understand the importance and the vitality of image, of what we experience in dream, in creative states, in ritual. And part of the reason why I think it is such a potent form of experience is that it bypasses the linguistic. It bypasses the rational part of ourselves that very often wants to take control and to define and you know, suss out a particular meaning. The image itself may not even have any apparent meaning other than the impact that it has upon our, you know, each of us as we experience it. And I think the key is developing an ability to understand context. I think that's actually a vitally important aspect of what our occult work is. We have these experiences, you know, for myself, going back to, as I mentioned, very early on, where they were every bit as palpable and as vital as they would be in my adult life. But I had no magical training. I had no context. I had no context of history, of magical techniques, of understanding how these things can be used, how they can be drawn upon to create art, to, you know, further one's particular spiritual work. So a lot of my work in my teens and in my 20s was really just a means of developing a language or a grammar to help give these visions a context and a depth of meaning, and allow me to continue on this path and go further along. That's definitely, I think, where it's rooted in image, and it flowers into this ability to peer into what would be called the hidden world, the elemental world, the invisible world, manifests in these kinds of very often fantastical images that are seen with the mind's eye, but are nevertheless, in my opinion, every bit as valid and as important as those things that we see with the physical eye.
Yeah, no doubt. Thank you. Wow.
You're welcome.
Yeah, that sounds great. I'm sure we would like to go back to Sylvan Dread a bit later again, but now that you have mentioned your youth and the origin of those thoughts and your dreams and everything, maybe that's the moment that you would tell us a bit more about about who Richard Gavin is and what brought you to be the writer and the esotericist that you are today.
Absolutely, yes. Well, I'm a Canadian writer. You know, as I mentioned, my roots in a lot of the esoteric were found in these early states of dream and almost like a trance state. I think the way that I discovered writing and the form of storytelling that I continue to work at to this day was at a very young age, I discovered a kind of lifeline, if you will, in Gothic horror. There was something that spoke to me deeply in the images and the atmospheres of monsters and these supernatural tales, and the whole ambiance of Gothic horror was really the first portal that I kind of walked through and was completely enchanted by it. And it led me to try my hand at writing my own, you know, little stories as a child. So these kind of amateur tales. But more importantly, as I grew older, I began to realize that many of the classics of supernatural literature and Gothic literature incorporate a lot of principles of esotericism, of philosophy, of Gnosticism. And as I grew older and began reading more philosophy and began experimenting with ceremonial magic, I began to see that these principles inform stories, but they were not necessarily created by the writers. They may have been employed for the purposes of dramatic flair, but they were not just constructs of the human imagination. They had a long, rich history, and that there were other people involved in these types of works that dealt with these principles more directly, be it Gnostics, be it Sufis, be it ceremonial magicians. And that's what led me through to initially a lot of ceremonial magic. I was deeply interested and worked quite heavily with Kenneth Grant's work of the Typhonian Current. And I remain interested in that. And I've discovered a lot of figures through the annals of occultism that really appeal to me. People like Rosalie Norton and Austin Osmond Spare and Robert Cochran, a lot of these figures I would research, and I felt an affinity with them because they also not only had the same sort of interests that I had, but also had a conviction about the hidden world, about living a life that is richer and more deeply connected with spirits and with the, you know, the numinous realm. It's, you know, that is something that continues on with me to this day. So that's basically me in a nutshell.
Thank you.
Yeah, Richard, I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about this book, Sylvan Dread, because I know it's not, certainly not your first book. If I'm not mistaken, this is your fifth?
Yes, it is. It's my fifth collection. The way that it came about was I have known Daniel Schulke of Three Hands Press for quite a few years. He's a wonderful guy, and I get along really well with him. And we've been working on a few other projects here and there. We actually had co-edited an anthology entitled Penumbrae, which was published by Three Hands Press. And we got on to discussing the possibility of building upon this kind of foundation stone, which is what we hope to present with Penumbrae, because we were looking to, with that initial anthology, we looked to collect stories from writers both past and present that had as much an interest in the esoteric or the magical states of consciousness as they did in simply weaving narratives. We tried to give a nice cross-section of various approaches to both fiction and magic. And once that was established, we talked about possibly taking that further by having myself work on a full-length collection that dealt specifically with occult fiction. You know, fiction that was perhaps a bit more removed from traditional horror fiction, supernatural horror fiction, which is what I had become somewhat known for in my own field. And I was very excited by that prospect because I found that the ambiguity and the willingness to convey these kind of evocative experiences through fiction was becoming more and more appealing and more important to me. And so I suggested to Daniel the concept of stories that were loosely connected with the numinous and occult aspects of nature. And he was very receptive to that idea. And so we took some of the works that had been previously published in anthologies here and there, but had never been collected in a single volume. And I then wrote a series of new stories as well that had this, a similar ethos to them. And the result was Sylvan Dread. I'm you know, very happy with it. The excellent artist James Dunk created the cover art with Daniel's input, which I think is a very striking cover. And I'm very pleased with the outcome and very pleased with the reactions that I've had from readers.
Yeah, you should be. I mean, it's a beautiful book, and the cover art is striking, as you mentioned. It really is. And the story's fantastic, and there's no doubt Three Hands Press is very particular when it comes to what they publish. So I think there's no doubt that the book is really, really good, both from technical publication as well as the content goes. I think it's really well done volume. You should be proud of it.
No, thanks very much.
Greg mentioned, and I couldn't agree more, how within a few sentences, one gets drawn in into each story. But there is another means of style which also strikes me. And I wonder if this is conscious or, well, probably it is. But already in the subtitle of Sylvan Dread, it says Tales of Pastoral Darkness. And also all along the text, all along the stories, you get those opposites which are pastoral darkness, are opposites in a way, in normal sense. But all the way through the book, you have those opposites over and over again. For example, in the Primeval Wood story, it says, for every paradise is a netherworld and each metropolis its slum. You know, it's almost those pairs, but which you unite and make one of it. Are you such a holistic person, or what is it?
That's a very astute observation that you've made. And that's, I think that's the first that a reader's picked up on that. I think you're absolutely correct with it. There is a certain holistic aspect to both my fiction and my life in that the notion of each thing carrying a trace of its own opposite not only appeals to me on an aesthetic level or a creative level, it strikes me on a mystical level or a magical level. And part of the reason why I enjoy presenting these kind of paradoxes is that bewilderment is actually a very powerful, receptive state of being. You suddenly find yourself calling all kinds of different preconceived notions that you may have had into question. And these can run the gamut of any type of view of the world. And it comes down to that notion of, again, as I mentioned earlier, with the whole notion of a trickster god that upsets the apple cart simply for the sake of upsetting the apple cart in order for, you know, for us to scramble. Do we actually hold these convictions? Are these things opposite? If so, how? What affinities might they have? Is there a middle ground between these things? So these are the kinds of things that, as you mentioned, laying them forth in a text and even with the subtitle of the book, I hope that it does open the reader. It provides even just a little twinge of bewilderment or confusion or curiosity about how these things may be connected. You know, is there a marriage between them and at what level? It's a means of showing the mask in the mirror and realizing that nothing is ever what it seems. And that is a way of invoking that sense of mystery, which is absolutely vital to me, both as an occultist and as an author.
Yeah. Isn't it also that we need to experience that fear, that darkness, that stealth, whatever you would like to call it, in order to be a complete person?
Absolutely. One of the reasons why I specifically chose Dread as the moniker for the book is because the emotion of dread, the feeling of dread, is one that I think is woven in to the spiritual experience or the religious experience or the mystical experience, if you will. And the reason I say this is because dread is linked by definition to the unknown. It's dealing with that which is not yet manifest, and yet it is something that we sense. So there is this opening awareness of a kind of stretching of one's life experience. It's a deepening of perception. We don't quite know what it is. We sense it, but we can't define it. And that is actually a very powerful and beautiful emotion. And that's why I try to weave it in with notions like the pastoral setting or, you know, a sunny setting. Because it doesn't necessarily have anything to do with what we conventionally think of as being dreadful, you know, physical harm or death or, you know, a lot of these human cruelty, for instance. Those things can evoke dreadful emotions. But in this particular sense, I'm using it more in the way that the theologian Rudolf Otto wrote an excellent book entitled The Idea of the Holy. And he talks a lot about how the experience from a Christian perspective would be interacting with God, but a sense of the divine very often is linked to what he called the mysterium tremendum, which was a combination of trembling terror and indescribable awe and wonderment at this experience. And I think many people can relate to that. And I think that that is why a lot of stories through the occult fiction lineages of history are still so impactful today, even though social mores have changed. We may be living in a different culture than the author who wrote a particular story. The technologies have changed, and yet we can still be drawn in and impacted and can understand the perennial principle that is shining through this work, that is radiating through this work. And I think that that's part of the reason why dread and fear are so powerful, is because, as you mentioned, yes, it does provide an opportunity for us to fully experience life. While we might be maybe frightened by a particular real world experience or an artistic experience, the fact is we become instantly aware of being incarnate at that moment, and we become instantly aware of our environment and, you know, notions of life and death. So it's a very vital, direct, palpable form. And I think that that is why it's, while I don't think it can be invoked for its own sake, I think if you utilize dread in conjunction with perhaps something that is more philosophical or is more mystical or is more personal, what you wind up with is a very complete experience as both an author or as a reader with literature, because you are utilizing that emotion to open the reader up, at which point they can then experience this fuller, more robust, more vital reality.
Yeah, that's a really good point, I think. It makes me think, you know, because of your background and your ability to write and create these amazing tales, and to do exactly that, sort of opening up the reader to new awareness of reality, it's in many ways kind of like an initiatory or sort of experience for somebody to read this, whether they're really aware of it or not. But I imagine they would be, honestly.
Well, I greatly appreciate that. And that's certainly my aim. One of the great things about fiction is that it allows readers to wade as deeply as they wish. So, you know, I've had every possible measure of feedback from people who simply enjoy my works of fiction as stories and as entertainments. And that's great. There's absolutely nothing wrong with that. I never want readers to feel that they're missing the point of a particular story, because it's out there as a work of fiction. You can go as deeply as you wish. You know, at the other end of the spectrum, I've had really in-depth exchanges and correspondence with readers who are so attuned to, be it the Kabbalah or witchcraft or some form of ceremonial magic, that they pick up all sorts of nuances in the text that I was not even aware of. You know, I'm not even fully aware of all the implications, primarily because I try to convey the vision with as little translation as possible. I really do try to convey the vision or the impression or the experience that I may have had into the story as purely as possible, because I think that, as you mentioned, Greg, that allows a reader who may themselves not be a formal initiate, but nevertheless, they can be drawn in and experience something. And perhaps, you know, down the line, they may awaken to some other aspect of themselves that they may not have awoken to had they not encountered that narrative. So that's a really rewarding part. It's definitely one of the major driving factors as to why I still continue to work in the narrative form, because I think that it's the way to reach people. And I think it's vital, especially in this day and age where we tend to live these very muted lives and there is fewer and fewer opportunities for these kind of ecstatic experiences and these direct experiences. I think that this is one of the ways to continue to ensure that flame is fanned, that people can still awaken to these moments when they're just in solitude reading a story. They can suddenly be struck with a memory or an insight or some sort of personal revelation that they may not have otherwise had. So that's definitely a major reward for me, and it's one of my creative aims.
Without wanting to flatter you, I think you perfectly achieved that. And the way of attracting different kind of people, different kind of needs of people within the same work of art, within the same piece of music and fictional writing, I think that's a very special talent and quality and excellence that you have. I mean, take Romeo and Juliet, can be just a simple love story and can be seen as a philosophical work. That's a good example. And with that, you were comparing your fiction, if I remember well, with Blackwood and Macken, which mm-hmm. I agree with. But maybe that's my European side. But I also see a lot of Baudelaire, for example. Would you agree?
Absolutely. Baudelaire was certainly a touchstone for me. And actually, a number of poets, poetry in general, has influenced the way that I structure prose and the word selection, because I do believe that essentially what language can do is we are giving a grammar. I mentioned earlier learning a context for experiences that may sort of flitter away if you don't develop a contextual model for them. And I think that one of the esoteric powers that these types of stories have is that they really do create a grammar, and we understand both the power of words, and they create the ambience that is necessary for the sacred or the numinous to radiate through. And poetry is one of, if not the finest literary form that, you know, humans have invented to stir these deeper feelings in us and to make us appreciate, you know, these kind of romantic feelings, romantic in the classical sense of the word. And Baudelaire for me was certainly a touchstone. So I appreciate the comparison there.
Maybe this would be a good opportunity to talk a little bit about The Benighted Path. I'm not really familiar with the book, so maybe you could give us a little bit of an overview, because it sounds extremely interesting.
Absolutely. Well, you know, it came about in a typically fated way with a lot of occult experiences. I had first encountered the writings of David Beth back in probably around 2008, 2009, when he published his book, Voodoo Gnosis. Mm-hmm. Which is a spectacular book. And I know, Greg, I recall your Occult of Personality interview with him, which was excellent. After reading David's book, I was immediately struck with the notion of night consciousness, which was a principle put forward by Ludwig Klages, the late 19th, early 20th century German philosopher. And Klages referred to night consciousness as essentially being the visionary faculty. In fact, I believe there's a quote that says, in day consciousness, we perceive, but in night consciousness, we are visionary. And I confess I was, you know, not familiar with Klages prior to reading David's book, but was definitely struck with both being intimately familiar with this concept and yet having the exhilaration of a new theory. And over the course of time, I was fortunate enough to come to know David, and we corresponded now and again. And sometime in 2014, I believe, I was still so fascinated and had been jotting down various ideas and incorporating various aspects of my own ritual work to this concept of night consciousness that I was beginning to ponder the possibility of writing a longer piece of work, nonfiction esotericism, that explored my own views of what this night consciousness, a dark way of being, would be. And literally within a week of having this initial idea, I received a message out of the blue from David suggesting that his publisher, Theion Publishing, would be interested in seeing a book on night consciousness, and he felt that I would be a good person to write it. Would I be interested? So it was just one of those wonderfully fated moments that when it was presented itself, I couldn't resist, and I agreed and worked on the book throughout 2015. And ostensibly, The Benighted Path is a way to, I hope, not only describe this visionary state, this kind of biocentric way of interacting with the deeper world, but also through the prose itself and through some of the concepts that it discusses, I hope to actually evoke that state within the reader. So The Benighted Path is essentially an exploration of how we can link ourselves back to a more primordial way of existing within the world. You know, logic has done a lot of wonderful things for humanity, but it's also become something that we serve in a lot of ways. It's really become a blinder for us in the sense that now we've become so dependent on the rational and the reasonable that we tend to doubt anything that doesn't immediately fit into some sort of model of utilitarianism or of immediate, whether it's financial benefit or material benefit. And I think that's to our detriment. What night consciousness does is kind of approach the idea of stirring a more intuitive, a more receptive, a deliberately irrational means of interacting with reality. And I've as I mentioned at the beginning of the interview, with having this affinity for Gothic horror and just always having this passion for the macabre, I was never sure what it may have said about me or what it may have meant. But really what it became was a means of opening these hidden levels of reality and allowed me to experience the world with connection to spirit, with connection to the hidden, with understanding the beauty and the life-affirming in vitality and almost erotic fire of mystery, of not being in control, of being in these ecstatic states. Now, of course, occult lore is rife with all sorts of examples, whether it's Odin hanging himself from the tree between earth and sky for the nine nights, you know, and him being the furious master of ecstasy, or the various, you know, shamanic traditions through Siberia. There are all sorts of examples of these different technologies that humanity has employed, whether it's the donning of a mask, whether it is the igniting of a fire in a field under a starlit sky. These are the types of experiences that connect us profoundly to something that I refer to simply as the dark way, as an elemental way. So it's a means of trying to break some of those tethers of logic and reason and allowing oneself to have these kind of elemental, ecstatic experiences that will not make sense, that will grate against our sort of logical, solar-based forms of perceiving the world, of interacting with the world. So it's more of the Dionysian as opposed to the Apollonian experience. So in a nutshell, that's essentially what the Benighted Path deals with and what it hopefully evokes for readers.
Richard, I really appreciate the time you've taken to speak with us about your work. Obviously, you're quite thoughtful and insightful and quite a good writer, of course. I really appreciate the time.
It's absolutely my pleasure. It's been great talking to you both.
Richard, like what you have going on in terms of your upcoming work, or if there's anything you wanted to mention, any kind of appearances or...
At the moment, I am working on another volume of esotericism, but title and topic and so forth are still in the air. It's still in the works. I'll probably be completing the new work of esotericism sometime this year. So I would imagine it will be announced probably early 2018. That's the main project I've got in the works at the moment.
Excellent. Keep on the lookout for that.
In our membership section at chamberofreflection.com, Richard Gavin talks more about his manifesto and primeval gnosis, including some practical guidelines for listeners on how to become more embodied and thereby become more attuned to the natural states of mind. The intro music is Awakening by Paul Avgerinos, and the outro music is Dark Hushes Light by Mikal Evans. I'd like to remind you that although you're able to listen to this podcast at no charge, it costs time and money to create. We ask you to support our efforts and the creation of future podcasts by joining the membership section at chamberofreflection.com or subscribing via Patreon at patreon.com/occultofpersonality. And if you're already supporting the show or have done so in the past, my heartfelt thanks, and I salute you. Thank you.
this creature.